Let us pray.
Father, we thank you for the privilege of gathering together once again today. Thank you for this Bible study. Thank you because we trust in the presence of the Spirit to teach us and lead us to the depths of the truth of your word. We are praying, O Lord, you grant us understanding in your word today in Jesus' name. And we pray that you'll grant us all the help we need, all the grace we need, so that we'll live an overcoming life in Jesus' name. Help every one of us to stand. Every day, whatever the temptation, whatever the trial, help us, Lord, to live lives that are glorifying unto you. Give us understanding your word today. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. We praise the name of the Lord for bringing us back again to our Bible study as we still continue in the study of the general epistle of James. We've already covered verses 1 to 12 of chapter 1. And today we're looking at chapter 1, verses 13 through to 18. Let me just read verse 13 to you to lead us into this study. Let no man say, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempt he any man. You will notice in that verse that the word tempt in the past tense as well as in other tenses comes up quite a number of times. It says, when he is tempted. When a man is tempted, it's not saying if there is a certainty that there will be temptation. But then when he is tempted, let him not say that I'm tempted of God. Then he tells us the reason why he shouldn't say that. Because God cannot be tempted with evil. And then he tells us in the present tense, neither does he ever tempt anyone. Our study today is talking about something which is fundamental and important. Because it deals with the understanding of something very essential in our lives. The title of the study is Understanding Temptation and Victorious Living. As the issue of temptation is common to all, so is the weakness of blaming others, or sometimes even blaming God, is common to those who fall into temptation. That's why the apostle is telling us, let nobody say, whenever he is tempted, that he is being tempted of God. Of course, many are ignorant of the source of temptation. They are ignorant of the process of temptation. They are generally too proud to accept the workings of lust within them or evil desires within them when they easily fall into temptation. Ignorance and pride combining together push men and women so far to the place to accuse God as the tempter, as the one enticing them or soliciting them to do evil. That's why the apostle is telling us very, very clearly that we have to be very careful what we say whenever we experience temptation. God neither can directly tempt nor remotely tempt anyone to sin or damnation, and eventually cause damnation. He who sent his only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to save us from sin, how can he at the same time tempt us or lead us to sin from which he wants to save us? If we really understood the truth, we will know that Satan is a great accuser of God and man. He is the one that is at the wicked business of telling us that God is the one tempting us, that he doesn't love us, that he wants us to fall, that he wants us to lose eternal life. But really, the devil is a liar. Because the word of God is very clear as to the mind of God in the area of sin, in the area of temptation. He wants us to live the victorious life and he wants us to get to heaven at last. Look at the scripture in Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 23 is asking a question. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, says the Lord God, and not that he shall return from his ways and live? The answer comes to us in verse 32. For I have no pleasure in the death of him that died, says the Lord God. You will see here that he's telling us he doesn't have any pleasure in the fall of anyone, in yielding to temptation of anyone, and therefore he does not tempt to sin, he does not lead into sin. In this same Ezekiel chapter 33, and in verse 11, say unto them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. The Lord is repeating it once again, reminding us, he doesn't have any pleasure in anyone falling, in anyone sinning, in anyone going into spiritual death. That is not his will. It's not his pleasure. It says, but that the wicked shall turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will ye die, O house of Israel? In the New Testament, in 2 Peter chapter 3, and in verse 9, it's still the same emphasis of the will of God, of the mind of God. He does not tempt, he does not lead us into evil. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards what? Not willing that any should perish. You see that? If he wanted us to perish, then he could tempt us, he could entice us, he could lead us into sin, but he's not willing that any should perish. Rather, he wants all to come to repentance. Who then is making the suggestion to us that is God tempting us, that it is God wanting us to fall? Is God bringing temptation that we cannot overcome in our way? Who is making that suggestion in our ears, in our mind, in our hearts? Is the devil, because he is a liar. In John chapter 8, verse 44. John 8, verse 44. Ye are of your father the devil, the Lord was telling the Jews, and the laws of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. So you see then, if you are having any thought within you that God is the one tempting you, is the one wanting you to fall into sin, remember, that's a lie of the devil. The devil is a liar. Well then, who tempts us? And why are we tempted? And what gives temptation so much strength to overcome some people? How can we be victorious? And what provision has God made for our victory and for our holiness? The scriptures answered these questions and many other questions related to temptation and victorious living. And that's why we're here today, looking at the passage we want to study, so that we'll be able to see how to be victorious and to know the source of all these temptations. Let's come back now to James chapter 1. We're going to read the whole text now from verse 13. Let no man say, when he's tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, do not go astray, do not be mistaken, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of false fruits of his creatures. I pray the Lord will grant every one of us understanding in his word, in Jesus' name. We're going to divide the study today into three parts. Number one, the perception of the truth. The perception of the truth. Number two, the process of temptation. The process of temptation. And number three, the provision for our triumph. The provision for our triumph. Let's see number one, the perception of the truth. We go back to this verse 13, very important verse. Let no man say, whoever the man may be, whatever his temptation may be, whatever his circumstances may be, and whatever the outcome of the temptation may be, let him never say. Let no man say when he is tempted. At the time you are being tempted, if you have the wrong thought, if you have the wrong idea, if you place the, if you shift the blame of the temptation or your weakness or your succumbing to that temptation, if you place it on the wrong source, you will not be able to get the victory. Therefore, if you want to have the victory, let no man say, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Don't mention the name of God as a guilty one, as the one that is leading you to sin, as the one that is making you to do evil. Let no man ever say, I am tempted of God. Why? Because that's contrary to his nature. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. You see, it is the perverseness or depravity of man that will make man to ever think that God can be responsible for temptation and for sin in a direct manner. In Proverbs chapter 19 verse 3. Proverbs chapter 19 verse 3. The foolishness of man perverteth his way. It is not God perverting our way. It is not God making us to fall. It is the foolishness of man, the foolishness in man, the weakness in man that perverteth his way, and his heart fretteth against the Lord. He even tries to accuse God. He frets against the Lord. He is angry against the Lord. He puts the blame upon the Lord. And yet it is his foolishness leading him astray. It reminds us of the attitude and the excuse and the passing of the buck by our parents, our foreparents, that is Adam and Eve. Do you remember after they had sinned and they had disobeyed the Lord, and the Lord came to ask, where are you now? Where are you spiritually now? Where are you now? Are you in the place I placed you? Are you still in the place the way I made you? Where are you now? Let us see the answer of Adam in Genesis chapter 3 from verse 9. And God called, and the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Thou wast naked. Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? Have you disobeyed? Have you yielded to temptation? Have you sinned? Have you eaten what I told you not to eat? Instead of saying, yes, I did. I'm sorry I sinned. And I'm sorry I'm feeling guilty. And I need pardon. And I need you to love me, and I want you to do whatever you can do so that I get out of this net into which I put myself. No, he will not say that. What did he say in verse 12? And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. I don't think it's my fault. It's the woman that you gave me to be a partner. It's the one that has led me astray. I wouldn't have done it except that you made the woman to be with me. And I think clearly you have to accept responsibility for this. It is not my fault. It is the woman's fault. And it is not just the woman's fault. It is your fault. That's why, because the writer of the epistle to general epistle of James, because he knew it has become a common thing for people to place the blaming on God from the time of Adam. That's why he says, let no man say when he's tempted that I'm tempted of God. And what was the case of Eve? Look at verse 13. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, I'm guilty? No. I sinned? No. And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. Now you can see the attitude there. They were really saying, not my fault. It's not my fault. It's the fault of the creature that you have made. And that attitude continued even into the Old Testament, as we see in Isaiah chapter 63. Isaiah chapter 63, verse 17. O Lord, why hast thou made us to err from thy ways, and hardened our hearts from thy fear? They said, O Lord, we discovered that we are backsliding. We discovered that we have gone astray. We discovered that we didn't stay in the path of righteousness. Why have you made us like that? Why did you make us to go astray? Why have you tempted us so much? You have even taken us now out of the right way. You see the depravity of man. They were placing the accusation on God, that it was God that had done that. That is always the attitude of people today. As Adam and Eve shifted blame for their sin, so many today blame God for their temptation and sin. And what a terrible thing for human nature and depravity, to blame God or to blame their circumstances instead of accepting the blame for their sin, and instead of seeking God's mercy, forgiveness, and salvation. But you see, as God cannot be tempted with evil himself, so neither can he be a tempter of others. He cannot be a promoter of what is opposed to his nature. It is very bad to sin, but it is much, much worse when anyone has sinned to accuse God of causing him to do the evil. But how do we say, or why do we know that God cannot cause us to sin, that is not responsible for our fall? Well, because the nature of God is a nature that is holy. He hates sin, and he is supposed to sin. And therefore, he cannot lead us, he cannot cause us to sin. Look at what the Bible says in Psalm 5, verse 4. Psalm 5, verse 4. For thou art not a God that has pleasure in wickedness, neither shall evil dwell with thee. He does not have pleasure in sin. He does not have pleasure in your falling into sin or doing evil. He wants you to live a righteous life. He cannot be the agent of evil at the same time. In fact, Habakkuk tells us very clearly in Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 13, the first part of verse 13, thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity. It's not in his nature to tempt anyone. It's not in his nature to lead anyone into evil or into sin, because God is holy. He's holy through and through. In Leviticus chapter 19, verse 2, we see the nature of God. Speak unto all the congregation of the children of Israel, and say unto them, ye shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. I, the Lord your God, am holy. Because of his holy nature, he has nothing to do with sin. And when anybody sins, he is not responsible for the sin of that individual. He tells us the same thing about his holy nature in Leviticus chapter 20, verse 26. And ye shall be holy unto me, for I, the Lord, I am holy. And I have severed you, separated you from other people, that you should be mine. He says, I want you to be holy. Now think about it. How can our great God, who wants us to be holy, how can he tempt us to go and sin at the same time? No, he is not responsible for anybody falling into sin, anybody falling into temptation. The scripture is full of the holiness nature of God in Psalm 99. Psalm 99, verses 5 and 9. Psalm 99, verse 5, exalt ye the Lord our God, and worship at his footstool. Why? Because for he is holy. In verse 9, exalt the Lord our God, and worship at his holy hill. Why? For the Lord our God is holy. And therefore it is very clear from scripture that the Lord our God is holy. And because he is holy, he wants us to be holy. He wants us to be pure. Therefore, he's just telling us something, that let nobody accuse God of being responsible for his sin, or responsible for his fall, or responsible for his backsliding. God is holy. God is pure. God is perfect. He is not an agent of temptation. Evil of any type has no place in him, and he has no delight in making anyone to do evil. Evil or sin can never be an act of God. You know that there are people, whenever something bad happens, oh, they will say, just accept it, that it's an act of God. If it's an evil sin, if it's a sinful sin, we Christians should understand that that evil thing cannot originate from God. Evil or sin cannot be, will never be, an act of God. Now concerning temptation, concerning sin, who leads people, who tempts people so that they will fall into sin. And then who helps his own people so that we will not fall into sin. Let me just show you two verses of scripture. One talking about the one that wants us to sin, the one that wants us to be condemned, the one that wants us to fall and to lose our relationship with God. And then the other verse telling us who wants us to stand, who wants us to be victorious. And let's see what each one of them, what they do. In 1 Chronicles chapter 21. 1 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 1. And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel. If there is anything within you provoking you, telling you to hurry up, do that thing, and that thing is an evil thing, that thing is a bad thing, and the temptation is strong and getting stronger, and the thing is pushing you and provoking you, do it, do it, do it, that's not God, that's the devil. Satan stood up against Israel and provoked and pushed David to number Israel. But on the other hand, the other verse now that shows who is the one restraining us, who is the one controlling us, who is the one holding our hand, who is the one checking us, who is the one whenever temptation comes that is trying to preserve us so that we will not sin. That's our loving God. In Genesis chapter 20, Genesis chapter 20, verse 6. And God said unto him in a dream, yes, I know that thou didst this in the integrity of thine heart, for I also withheld thee from sinning against me. Therefore suffered I thee not to touch her. Do you see the love of our God? Do you see the restraining power of our God? While the devil on the one hand is pushing people, provoking people, telling them to hurry up and wanting them to commit sin, it is God that is holding us with his restraining hand, saying that no, he doesn't want us to sin. He wants to keep in fellowship with us. He restrains us from doing evil. That's why we're back in James now. Chapter 1, verse 13 is reminding us, let no man ever say when he is tempted that I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. How does temptation come then? And why does temptation come? And who is responsible eventually if anyone falls into temptation? What is it within man that acts like the bait that makes him to go into sin? That leads us to point number two. The process of temptation. The process of temptation. There is a process here that we can see very clearly. Look at it from James chapter 1, verse 14. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Here he is telling us how temptation comes. It tells us the beginning. It tells us the process. And it tells us the consummation of that temptation. It tells us, number one, a man is tempted when he's drawn away. And then he says he is enticed. He uses those two expressions. Number one, drawn away. That's what those words, drawn away, actually means lured into a trap. In the original language, it's a hunting term. It's like when a hunter is going after an animal and wants to catch the animal, and he draws the animal into a net with a particular bait. Then the other word, enticed, is actually in the original a fishing word. That means when a fisherman wants to catch fish, he does not throw the bare hook into the sea or into the river, but he puts a bait, something appealing, onto the fish. And then when the fish will see that bait, will not see the hook, then the fish is enticed. And while the fish is trying to grab and take hold of that bait, then he sucks in the hook, and through that hook that is very sharp, then the fisherman is able to draw the fish. It's the same picture that is being used here, that if the devil is going to catch anyone, if temptation is going to catch anyone, there is lust within. There is a propensity for evil within. And if that propensity for evil is not checked, is not controlled, is not subdued, is not put under some cover, then the bait will draw that individual, and while you are trying to catch the pleasure, then the pain will come. Eventually you are hooked by the devil and you are drawn away from where you are feeling the convenience, like the fish is drawn away from the river. Actually, it is Satan that brings temptation, but God provides the strength and the grace and the power to overcome. And Satan, with demons and men and circumstances, as they conspire together to tempt man, yet there is something in man that makes that temptation to be powerful, that makes him to be enticed, that makes him to be drawn away. In James chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your own lust, that war in your members? Is telling us here that the devil will not have been able to get victory over us if we ourselves did not have the lust. Something that is drawing us, something that can be enticed. He said, ye lust and have not, ye kill and desire to have. It's not inordinate desire, it's that a consuming passion within a man to want something that is contrary to the will of God, and he cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, ye have not because ye ask not. Instead of asking from God and getting it from God, we want to get it the illegitimate way. That is what actually gets us into trouble eventually. As we talk about the process of the temptation, let's look at a verse of scripture that is very, very descriptive, that will show you that temptation catching a person, temptation hooking a person, temptation that is tying a person, throwing a person into the net, is actually a process. In Joshua chapter 7, Joshua chapter 7, verses 20 and 21. You know the story. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord, against the Lord God of Israel. And thus have I done. But Achan, we have a question. How did this temptation take hold of you? Achan, can you tell us, was it just that all of a sudden you were surprised into it? Or was there a process by which you were drawn into the thing, and you were enticed and you were drawn away? And Achan is telling us in verse 21, there was a process. Look at verse 21. When I saw, please mark that word, saw. That's a verb. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then, you see the then there, is telling us there is a process. First I saw, but that's not seen yet. See something, you just saw something that didn't have any consequence, but then I coveted them. That's another verb. Mark the word, coveted. That's the process now. And took them. That's the third verb, took. And took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. I saw, I coveted, I took. That's the process. I saw, I desired it, I wanted it, I began to meditate on the thing. I began to put my attention on that thing now. I coveted those things, and eventually the action followed, and I took. For you to be able to remember, I've used some words here. It's on your outline. The first thing is desire, and then deception, and then decision, and then the final act of sin, disobedience. And when you talk about the desire, that is in the emotion to start with.
And then when you are talking about the deception, it's now in your mind. And then as you are talking about the decision, it's now in your will. And when you talk about the disobedience, that's now the behavior, the wrong behavior. And so you will see here the process of sin, or the process of yielding to temptation. The first step, it begins with a desire to be satisfied with a forbidden sin, and that affects the emotion. It affects the emotion. And I want to tell you something. If you want to overcome sin, if you want to overcome temptation, the point to start to overcome is at the first point, at the emotion. Let's say somebody is looking at a bad picture, and then there's an emotion within you. You stop that sin right there if you want to be an overcomer. If you don't stop it at the time of the emotion, when your emotion is aroused, then your mind is going to want to be thinking about it, and you'll be deceived. And in that deception, sin is being conceived. It's being conceived. Eventually, there'll be a decision that you want to go after that sin, and you want to do it. Your will is now involved, and eventually it will result into bad behavior. But you see, to start with, there's a desire to be satisfied with a forbidden thing, which affects the emotion. Then number two, there comes the deception in the mind. And you begin to rationalize and justify the steps that you want to take. And the devil begins to say, is it too bad after all? And after all, if you even fall into it, even if it is bad, you'll get out of it. You may even have the experience. Of course, if you don't even do this sin, how will you be able to have the experience to tell the people of the world? How will you be able to help the people of the world? Why don't you go into the evil sin? When you go into the evil sin, it will give you experience. You will not know how to be able to win the people that have gone into that evil sin. Rationalization will come in. Your mind is now getting involved. And now you take a decision. And in that decision, you will to sin, and you yield into the sin. At last, there's an act of disobedience, which manifests itself in wrong behavior. How do we deal with that sin? How do we deal with that temptation? As I told you, it's at the point, at the first point, not at the last point. You see why many people do not have the victory? Is that when the behavior has come out in the wrong way, and when the disobedience has been done, it is at that time now they want to be able to overcome, and they begin to pray. It is at the first level you conquer that sin, you remove that sin. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 44. You've seen the process already. You've seen the desire, the deception, the decision, and then the disobedience. But let's look at the word of God more to see that it's a process that leads people into committing sin. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 20. He feedeth on ashes, A deceived heart has turned him aside, that he cannot deliver his soul, nor say, is there not a lie in my right hand? I've explained that to you already. There is a desire to do evil. And because of that, there's deception. And his deceived heart is turned aside, that now he cannot deliver himself, because his will, his mind, his emotion, everything is roped in. And then eventually he does not even know that there's a lie, there's an evil, there's a sin in his right hand now. Disobedience has taken over his life. In Job chapter 15, Job chapter 15, verse 35. Job 15, 35. They conceive mischief and bring forth vanity, and their belly prepares deceit. As it's using the word of conception, you know that's a process. You know that if a child is to be born, there is conception. And then with the process after this and after this and after that, eventually a child is born. And in the same way, when people fall into sin, there is a process, like we've read about Achan. He saw, he took, he saw, he coveted, and he took. In Psalm 7, verse 14. Psalm 7, verse 14. Behold, it travaileth with iniquity, and has conceived mischief, and brought forth falsehood. It travails, he has conceived, And then he brings forth. You can see the process there. And if you really want to be victorious, you will stop that sin. You will not even allow the conception. Because once the conception is there, you are not careful. You are going to fall into sin. You are going to bring forth sin. Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah 59. And in verse 4. None calleth for justice, nor any pleadeth for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and they bring forth iniquity. You see, there's conception, there's a bringing forth. It's telling us in all these passages that the people that fall into sin, many times it's not just a momentary sin. It's not just a sudden thing. There is a conception, there is something that has taken place, and eventually they bring forth. Let's come back to James chapter 1 and look at verse 15. James chapter 1, verse 15. Yes, telling us that the final result. It says, then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Bringeth forth death. The Bible is very clear that if somebody yields to sin, there is a terrible consequence. And that consequence is nothing short of death. In Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 4. Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 4. Behold, all souls are mine. As the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. In Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. The judgment, the end result, the final thing is death. Chapter 6 verse 21. What fruit are ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. And in verse 23, the wages of sin is death. As we're talking about this death, let's understand as students of the Bible that there are three types of death. Number one, spiritual death. That's separation of the soul from God. You might still be living. If you have gone into sin, you've yielded yourself to sin, then you are separated from God. Therefore, spiritual death has taken place. There's another death which everybody is familiar with, that is physical death. That's the separation of the soul from the body. When somebody dies physically, then the soul is separated from the body. But then there's a third kind of death, revealed in Scripture, and it is eternal death. That's the separation of soul and body from God throughout all eternity. As we're studying all these things, we need to check up our lives because temptation comes to everyone. And there are people that have yielded to temptation. And when you yield to temptation, the final thing is that there's going to be the judgment, which is death. Remember Achan? He died eventually. Remember Saul, the first king of Israel, because of his sin, he died. That's a penalty. Remember Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, he became leprous and eventually he died under the judgment and the displeasure of the Lord. Remember Samson, he lost his two eyes because he fell into sin. He yielded to temptation. He died prematurely too. You remember Balaam, that prophet? He was really a prophet of God, but because of the covetousness, he knew the will of God, but the love of money was too much on him. He fell into that temptation. Eventually, he died. You remember Absalom? He wanted position so much, and he wanted it the wrong way. Eventually, it was death. You remember Jezebel, that woman that made Ahab the king of Israel to do so much evil because of the sin. Eventually, you remember when she was peeping out of the window, they said, throw her down. And then she was thrown down, and even dogs at her body. You remember Judas Iscariot? You remember Ananias and Sapphira? You will remember that all these people, they died because of their sin. And of course, if any of us, if we're yielding to temptation, remember that although you may hide it from the eyes of men, you cannot hide it from God. Because we're told that there is no creature that is not manifest in his sight. All things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. That's why the members of the choir, sometimes they sing and they remind us, he sees all you do, he hears all you say. My God is watching all the time. Be very careful. We go to point number three now. Provision for our triumph. Thank God there is provision for us to triumph, for us to be victorious. We look at verse 17. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and coming down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Already we have learned that evil cannot be associated with God, and evil cannot be traced unto God. Only good, unending good, unbounded good, unlimited good comes from God. He is the inexhaustible fountain of every good gift and every perfect gift. Instead of taking the devil's bait, which will result in our death and doom, we should receive the grace of God and the good things from God, which will give us temporal satisfaction as well as eternal satisfaction. From him proceeds every good and perfect gift, both pertaining to this life and pertaining to the life that is to come. God is always good and gracious. He does not change. He will never change. In fact, this verse I've read to you says, "Is the Father of lights. With him, there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." In 1 John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. "This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. God is good and there is no evil with him. God is holy and there is no sin with him. There is no darkness in him at all. And there is no change, there is no variableness or shadow of turning. He's always good. He has always been good. He will always be good." We're told in Psalm 102. Psalm 102, verse 27. "But thou art the same, thy years shall have no end." Here he tells us that our God is always the same, that his years have no end. He's telling us that that good nature that he had, he still had that good nature. The good nature that he had when he restrained Abimelech. And he said, "I'm the one that restrained you, that did not allow you to commit sin against me." That God is still good and is good unto everyone. And if you will lean upon him, you will find that he will restrain you from sin. He will not allow you to fall into temptation. We're told of the unchangeable nature of God, his immutability, in Numbers chapter 23. Numbers chapter 23, verse 19. "God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent," that is, that he should change his mind. "As he said, and shall he not do it? As he spoken, and shall he not make it good?" We understand then that our God is good. There is no evil with him. He has grace, he has goodness, and if we go to him, he'll give us that goodness. In fact, we are told in James chapter 1, verse 18, "Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." He said, "Of his own will he begat us." That is, we are born again by his will. That's what we learn from John chapter 1, that if you are born again today, if your sins are forgiven today, that's because of the will of God. In John chapter 1 verse 12, "And as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." That means they are born again. But how are they born again? "Which were born, not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." That is, of the will of God. "Of his own will begat he us." Of his own will, he makes us to be born again. And if you are born again already, that's the love of God for you. And if he has shown that love, obviously, he wants you to live a victorious life. If he didn't want you to take you to heaven, he will not have caused you to be born again. How were you born again? "Of his own will he begat us by his word, the incorruptible seed." 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to start with. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again by his mercy, we are born again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Verse 23. In verse 23, it tells us being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God. We are born again by the word of God which liveth and abideth forever. So then we understand that because he is a God, because God is love, he makes us to come to him and he makes us to be born again. Then he uses a particular language in James chapter 1 verse 18, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. What does that mean? That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. In the Old Testament, we don't have the time. You can read it later on your own. You'll find it in Leviticus. The references there on the outline, Leviticus chapter 23. You will see that the first fruits were dedicated unto God, were devoted unto God. And therefore, the first fruits were supposed to be holy because they specially belonged to the Lord. And it was a symbolic teaching for the children of Israel, because Jeremiah gives us the interpretation in Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 3. Israel was holiness unto the Lord, the first fruits of his increase. You see that? That's the implication. The first fruits were devoted to God. The first fruits were totally given unto God, consecrated to God. And the children of Israel as a whole, because they were redeemed, because their sins were forgiven, because they were taken out of the land of Egypt to be his own, they became holiness unto the Lord, and they were supposed to be the first fruits. And we now, because we are begotten by the living word, we have become the first fruit. And the thing is that the first fruit ought to be holy. Look at it in Romans chapter 11. Romans 11, verse 16. For if the first fruit be holy, and the lump is also holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches. You know, he is the root, Christ is the root, and we are the ones that he is bearing. Therefore, we ought to be holy. He is holy, we ought to be holy. In fact, we are the first fruit, and as the first fruit, we ought to be holy. In Revelation chapter 14, Revelation chapter 14, still reminding ourselves of the implication of being the first fruit. Revelation chapter 14, verse 4, these are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins, they are holy, they are pure like virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. Because they are the first fruits, they are devoted to God. Because they are the first fruits, they are following the Lamb and following the Lord. And because they are the first fruits, they are redeemed and they do not defile themselves with any kind of evil. That tells us then that we ought to be victorious. Victorious over sin. Victorious over evil. Although there is temptation in the world, although the time in which we are living now is a time of temptation, but we're going to be victorious. And we will be victorious in Jesus' name. What are the reasons for us being victorious? Number one, we are the first fruits, belonging to God wholly, completely. Because of that, he protects us as his treasured property, as the apple of the eye of the Lord. He's watching over us. He doesn't want anything to contaminate our lives. He wants to keep us holy. He is preserving us. He is jealously guarding us. Because we are the first fruits, because of that, we ought to be victorious. Number two, because temptations are actually common and ordinary. And there is nothing happening to you now that has not happened to another believer, and that believer has overcome. And the way God loves that other believer who is overcoming, the same way he wants to help you, because he's providing a way of escape that you'll be able to escape and overcome. Number three, because Satan is limited. Satan is limited. In fact, he commands. That is Almighty God commands and says, hitherto shalt thou come and no further. That's in Job chapter 38 verse 11. Hitherto you will come and no further. He moderates everything. He limits everything. Because of the limit he puts on Satan, you will not fall in Jesus' name. You know those temptations? The Lord will not allow the temptation to get to the point where you will not be able to overcome. Number four, because of God's word in us, which is the sword of the Spirit. And because of that sword of the Spirit, we're able to overcome the devil, overcome the flesh, overcome the world. Number five, because of the grace of God that is sufficient. And every time there is temptation, remember the Lord is telling you, my grace is sufficient for you. And His Spirit is so mighty. And His promise and power to keep will never, never fail. Number six, because if you are truly a child of God, if you are truly one of His sheep, you are following the Lord, He says no man is able to pluck you out of the Father's hand. The devil will not be able to pluck you away. Temptation will not be able to pluck you away. As you have been saved and your name is in the book of life, we will meet on that day in the presence of the Lord in Jesus' name. And eventually, number seven, He's able and willing to keep you from falling. He will keep you from falling. Resist the devil. Stand firm in biblical conviction. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. He kept other people. He will keep you. You remember Enoch? He is in heaven now. You remember Samuel? And you remember other people like Paul, like Peter, like John? He kept them. And that same God, He will keep every one of us in Jesus' name. Now, unto Him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless, no blame, no fault, no evil, no sin, before the presence of His glory, with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forever. Amen. Well, rise up and tell the Lord, I know You can keep me. And I know You are going to keep me. Although temptation may be there, I'm not going to fall. I will cut off that thing at the first entrance, at the first appearance. When the emotion is being affected, that's when I'm going to control that thing. I will not allow that thing to get into my mind. I will not allow my will to come into that thing. I will not allow my behavior to become disobedient. I will not allow any evil. I will overcome. You will overcome. You will overcome. You will overcome. Tell the Lord, I need Your grace. Tell the Lord, I need Your spirit. Tell the Lord, I need Your strength. There is no temptation taking you but such as is common unto men. And with the temptation, He will make a way to escape. You will escape. If anybody yields to sin, remember the result is death. The Lord is standing by you. He says, my grace is sufficient for you. He says, I will help you. He will not let you fall. Commit your life unto Him, unto His hand, and He will keep you from falling.